Imagine that you want to find the mass of a 1 meter long radius circular metal plate, to see if you can lift it without hurting yourself. However, this plate is not homogeneous, but has instead a density that grows as we move away from the center. This is a problem, because normally we would multiply the density of an object for its surface to find its mass. But now, the density is not a number, but instead a position-dependent function. So, how do we get out of this? The tools that will help us are double integrals. In a moment, I will explain what they are. But first, let me make some premises. If you are familiar with the concept of function, that is the correlation between some variables by using a mathematical formula, you probably already know that the best way to visualize a one-variable function is by plotting a bunch of points in the xy plane that are arranged according to the type of function we are studying. If we do that for every point that the function allows us to create, the points themselves are now so numerous and so close together that it becomes more convenient to represent the function as a curve. It's important to understand that every point on this curve has an x-coordinate that can be freely chosen and a y-coordinate that is the value of the computed function on the x-coordinate. Now, imagine that we want to evaluate the area under this curve on a certain x range. The best strategy is to raise many rectangles that has a delta x base and that raise until they touch the function. You will agree with me when I say that to have an ever more precise area, we need to have finer and finer rectangles. In this case, we replace the name delta x with dx, underlying the fact that the base of the rectangles becomes very, very small. When you use this technique, it's said that we are evaluating an integral of a function in an a-b range. The symbol to the left represents the s of sum, because, as we said before, an integral is just an infinite sum of base times height. Let's now extend this concept on a higher dimension. Imagine, in fact, a set of points on the xy plane that are raised to a certain height, depending on where each point is located. We are now obtaining a function of two variables that can be visualized as a surface that will have a trend depending on the type of function we are studying. Suppose now that we want to evaluate the volume under this surface on a certain domain D. In a very similar way as the one we used before, we could raise from the domain D a prism until it touches the surface. We now apply the same logic as before. The more and the finer these prisms will be, the more precise the volume will be. To find the volume under a function of two variables is to evaluate a double integral. Now, it's a very small consolation the fact that a double integral is evaluated this way. I do not certainly have all the time in the world to make infinite sums. Then, how can you really find these volumes? The goal of this video is to show you the answer. First, let's discuss a fact. While for a single integral, the domain could be just a line or a set of lines, for a double integral, every shape on the xy plane could be a base for our volume. So, during this video, we will see what changes if our domain is a rectangle, if it is the area between two functions of one variable, or if it is a figure that requires a change of coordinates. Let's begin with rectangles. A rectangle is what you obtain if you plot every possible dot with an x-coordinate defined in an a-b range and a y-coordinate defined in a c-d range. Remember, there is no correlation between these two variables. As long as you choose randomly an x and y value inside those intervals, the dot obtained will still belong to the rectangle. How do we find the volume over this figure? The first step is to evaluate a simple integral in a single variable, pretending the other variable is a generic constant. So, we can find the area e.g. in the y range, but this area will also depend on the x-coordinate we are in. Thus, if the first step gives us an area that depends on the x value, The second step will be adding all the areas for all the values of x to find the volume. From this point of view, you can rightly say that a double integral is an integral of integrals, because we are making sums of areas, which are, in turn, sums of rectangles. Furthermore, the volume will be the same even if we swap the order of integration, because the process will be the same. For those who are interested, I provide you this exercise, a double integral of a function on a rectangular domain. If you are here only for a qualitative view of the topic, you can skip this 2-minute part of the video. But if you want to deal with this exercise, just remember to follow the 2 steps we discussed earlier. First, integrating the y variable, considering the x as a constant. In this way, you will find the area under the function on the y range at a generic value of x. After some calculation, you'll notice that you will have only a one variable function that can be integrated in the x. The final integral you will obtain is the sum of all the areas for all the values of x in its range, and, therefore, is right the volume you are looking for. So, you can proceed to the second step, that is evaluating this final integral. If you want, you can repeat this exercise by swapping the integration order, and you will see, as I will show you on this animation, that the result will be just the same as before. Let's complicate the things a little more. Imagine now a region between two functions of one variable, g1 of x and g2 of x. In a figure like this, while the x range can be freely chosen, the y range will depend on the x coordinate we are in, because of the two functions that surround the figure. How does this affect our search for volumes? Well, this time, not only our areas will have an height that will depend on the two-variable function, but now also their width will change due to the constraints g1 and g2. So, because even the y range depends on the x value, we are now forced to first integrate in dy and then in dx to obtain our volume. Now that we have put things in a certain order, we can then proceed with the same technique as before. I now leave to you another interesting exercise, thanks to which you can prove to yourself that even if the shape of this domain is not a rectangle, in terms of calculation, the things you will have to do are nearly the same as the rectangle case. Let's now discuss on what to do if our domain is a circle. Its boundary, the circumference, is the set of all the points that maintains the same distance, called the radius, from a central point. Describing the points of a circumference with Cartesian coordinates isn't very simple, so we proceed with a new trick. We divide the radius in its two projections, r cos theta and r sin theta, with theta defined as the angle between the radius and the horizontal. And now, because the radius is a constant, the points of the circumference will be defined only by the theta variable. At this point, it's easy to see that the x-coordinate of a generic dot of the circumference will be equal to the x of the center plus r cos theta, while the y, similarly, will be equal to the y of the center plus r sine theta. What to say now about the inside of the circle? Well, every point of this figure can be defined with the same coordinates as before. But now, also the distance between the center and a generic dot will be a variable, that we call rho. Notice now that it doesn't matter which value of rho and theta we decide. As long as we choose values that are inside the ranges that defines the circle, the dot obtained will still belong to the figure. But what does this remind you? We said before that the set of all the dots with unrelated coordinates is a rectangle. So, if we shift all the dots of the circle in a rho theta plane, they will dispose themselves to form this new figure. In fact, we just proved that a circle in these new polar coordinates becomes a rectangle. Not only that, but thanks to this new trick, we can transform even complex objects like circular crowns or sectors into rectangles that will change just in sides and positions. So, it's easy to see where we are going now. If we have a double integral on a circular domain, we just need to make a transformation from Cartesian to polar coordinates and then integrate on this new rectangular domain, right? Wrong. Our transformation is not complete yet. When we compute the simple integrals, it's sometimes convenient to substitute a piece of our function with a new variable t. But then, also the dx will be transformed into a new function times dt. This is because if we want to keep the same area of a rectangle whose height we have changed, the base will have to be changed accordingly. However, now we have two variables that depend on two new other variables. So what do we have to add when we transform from dx dy to d rho d theta? The answer is the Jacobian. Unfortunately, I don't have the time to show you precisely what the Jacobian is. If you want, I can make a video about it. However, for our discussion, it's enough to know that the Jacobian for the transformation from Cartesian to polar coordinates is a function simply equal to rho. Now we have all the pieces that we need to make the transformation right, and thanks to the Jacobian, our new integral can be finally evaluated. In a moment I will give you an example, but at this point you are now probably saying, okay, cool, but what are these double integrals for, aside finding these strange volumes? The applications in the scientific fields are such a lot, and now I will show you one. Remember our 1 meter circular plate? We still haven't figured out if we can lift it. The best thing to do is to divide this plate into many tiny rectangles that have an area ds equals to dx times dy. Every rectangle will have a different mass, depending on how far it is from the center. So, every tiny mass will be equal to the depending position density times the area of the rectangle. Let's put all of this in a reference system, where the origin is the center of the plate. Every point of this plate will have an x and y coordinate. So, its distance from the center will be, for the Pythagorean theorem, square root of x squared plus y squared. But since the density on an xy position depends on this distance, for simplicity we will say that it's equal to this distance, its formula will also have that expression. And so, to find the mass, we can sum all of the values of sigma times ds, and therefore integrate the density function over this metal plate. Since this is a circular domain, we can make a change of coordinates, multiply by the Jacobian, and then, after a very few calculations, see that our plate has a mass of 2/3 of pi, which is approximately 2.09 kilos. So, you can lift it up with no problems. This should show you that double integrals are not just for spatial volumes. In fact, if we plot the density function, which as expected grows as the distance from the center increases, the volumes obtained by this function in a certain region represent the mass of that same region. Well, the video is over. I hope you liked it, I hope you found it exhaustive and not exhausting, and if you have any questions about things I may not have been so clear about, feel free to write them on the comments. If you want, click the like and subscribe button, and share this video with friends that may like this topic. That would be very, very useful to me. Thanks!